Hello everyone, my name is Fong Nguyen.
And I'm Jacob Hernandez.
And we are the lead engineers here at LX Systems. And today we're going to be defending our design of the LX5P1440.
Now before we get started, we're going to just give you a brief overview of what we're going to be talking about in this presentation. So first we're going to just go off with what is the LX5P1440? Why did we decide to choose a pipeline implementation? And then we'll start digging deeper into the design implementation, the design verification, and then our future enhancements or future addition, the LX5P1440.
So first thing first, we need to talk about the naming convention of our processor. First, the LX is derives from the word Lusu in Mandarin. In English, it translates to bit by bit, which is really significant to Jacob and I, because that's exactly how we decided to approach designing our processor. We decided to take little by little, making sure each and every single part of the processor works properly. Next is the 5P. 5P is very straightforward. It represents the 5-stage pipeline that we decided to utilize. The 1 represents the first rendition of this processor, and the 440 represents the class in which we started developing this processor.
Now, why did we choose pipeline? Well, the main reason why is because we wanted something that can execute instructions very quickly. So that's what pipelining gives us. We can do both fetch and decode at the same time. For like the multi-cycle, for example, we can only execute or do one instruction at a time. So if we wanted to execute two different instructions, the first instruction needs to be finished first before the next one can be executed. Now in the diagram as you see below, doing a quick example of how this actually works for the multi-cycle. Let's take the load work instruction for example. The load work takes 5 clock cycles to complete, and then if you wanted to do a store word instruction, that will take an additional 4 clocks. So in total, that is 9 clock cycles for both of those instructions to complete. Now in a pipelining implementation, as I said earlier, one instruction is going to be fetched, on the next clock cycle, another one's going to be fetched. So in the same time, we can do multiple instructions until all of them are complete. So as you see on the very bottom here, you can see that the first instruction, load word, is being executed, or being fetched. The next clock, store word, will be fetched. And then by the end of the 6th clock cycle, both load word and store word are fully executed. Now in our RSA, we implemented a 32x32-bit register file, a 4 kilobyte program counter, and then we also added the status flag registers, which include the carry, negative, 0, and the overflow flag. We were also able to implement 3 different types of addressing modes, an immediate, register, and register indirect, 2 different types of data types, unsigned and signed 32-bit integer, and then we were able to accomplish or verify 28 different instructions in this design, which include a variety of R types, I types, and J types. Now our design implementation for the LX5P1440 includes, again, as we mentioned already, a 5-stage pipeline. We're utilizing a Harvard architecture, which includes 2 different types of memory modules. 50 registers are included, and as we progress further into the future enhancements, we'll be adding more registers to that. 20 different R-type instructions, 8 different I-type instructions, and then as I mentioned a little bit earlier, but for the J-type instructions, we're going to be adding those in our future enhancements. Also included will be the control unit, the instruction unit, integer data path, and the forwarding unit, which we'll get a little bit into detail further in this presentation.
As we mentioned multiple times already in this presentation, the heart and soul of our design is a 5-stage pipeline. The 5-stage pipeline have different stages of it. First, starting off with instruction fetch and instruction decode, which are included into the instruction memory. And then we also have to execute the memory and the write back stages, which are all included in the data path. All these stages combined will allow us to let data flow properly through the data path. So in order to make our pipeline actually work, we needed the usage of a control unit. So this control unit that we utilized was basically, in a sense, like a control word generator. So every single signal is generated from the very beginning, and then it starts making its way through the integer data path. In this example right here, I'm using Andy. Andy requires the usage of a tselect, which allows an immediate value to come in. It requires the usage of tenable, which allows it to write itself back into the register file, and the usage of DA select, which tells it to take the address of T address rather than D address as its destination.
Now, the first, as we mentioned already, the first few stages are the fetch and decode stage. Now, in our fetch state, it would be talking about the program counter. The program counter will automatically increment the address location in order to read certain instruction at that location in memory. Upon the decode stage, you'll be receiving a 32-bit output, which will then be broken up into several different fields to be decoded in the execution stage. Now, as I just said, the output of the instruction register is broken up into several different fields. Those specific fields have to do with the S address, the R address, the destination address. We also include a shift amount and either an opcode or a function code, which those get leaked into the control unit that we just mentioned earlier. Now, all those data get saved to specific registers. So as shown below, the RA register would represent the register address, which will save all the addresses for that instruction. So again, we have the S address, the R address, or the S address, the T address, and the D address. The shift amount will be included, which is a 5-bit value. The data that is coming from the register files will be saved to the RS address, or RS and RT registers. And then we have the immediate value, which will be saved to the DT register. And then we have all the control signals that were generated from the control unit gets all saved into the control signal register. Now during our execution stage, since all the signals are already in a register, we have the free will to do whatever operation we want. So again, in the control signal, we did generate a signal called FS, which does certain operations that the ALU are going to be executing. And so as you see up in the diagram above, we do have several muxes. Those we're going to get a little bit into more detail when we start talking about forwarding unit. But the main thing that I just want to get to is that all the data gets passed through all the muxes, goes through a certain ALU operation, and then gets saved to all the registers that that's shown below. Now the last two stages of our pipelining are the memory and the write-back. So in the memory, we're only going to be saving the data that's going to be utilizing the data memory. All that information will get taken from the DData register as shown above, and then any data that's coming out of the data memory will be saved to the DIN register. A few things to also note, that there are two wires in both of these stages that are actually leading directly back into the execution stage. Those specific wires are going to be used for the forwarding unit when we get to that.
Now, even though pipeline seems great and everything, there are two drawbacks into utilizing it. First, there's a lot of hazards that we can run into. First thing is going to be the structural hazard, which we absolve by using Harvard architecture. The structural hazard is when the pipeline tries to read and write to the same memory module at the same time during execution. And obviously, we have a separate instruction memory and data memory to be written and to be read from. Second would be data memory. Data memory is when an instruction requests content from a register in the clock cycle before. So if you have one instruction stacked on another and the second instruction requests, let's say, R1, then it's not available yet in the register file, so there's a hazard there as well. Lastly is control hazards. Control hazard is when you're trying to make decisions, but the pipeline's not able to fully flush such like that. As we mentioned several times, we want to talk about the forwarding unit. The forwarding unit is basically a block of combinational logic that allows us to compare the addresses of different stages to see where you need to forward the data. Now, this is a slightly complex logic. I'm just going to break it down to a very bare minimum. For this one right here, for the very top part, we're comparing the RD of the memory write back and the IDEX of the RS to see if that data is necessary to come back into the front of the ALU. If it is, then the max value will change to 2, and it'll bring that data forward. Same thing happens to the next stage, which is the EXMEM. The EXMEM and the IDEX of the RS are both compared, and if those two are the same, then the value comes forward into the front of the ALU. If these two conditions are not met, then it just takes the value from RS or RT. As the logic for both the RS and the RS forwarding logic and the RT forwarding logic are essentially the same. As you see here, this is a visual of what we have with the universal recording. Now, if we compare this stage, which is the memory write back, and IDEX, which is up here, if those two address, the RD is the same as the RS, then it'll take this green trail right here. If the EX mem and the IDEX are the same, then it'll take this green trail right here instead.
That was just the overall diagram of how our processors actually look like. You can see just a row of registers, one for the IR, one for the execution stage, and then we've got one for the memory stage, as well as the write-back stage. You can see, as Phil mentioned already, that there is a wire that's coming out of the memory write-back stage, being fed right into the register file. That's just used so we can save the data into the register file so that we can use it for further instructions.
Now that we've shown you our implementation of the pipeline architecture along with the forwarding unit, we want to go ahead and verify and show you guys our verification of the unit. Before I continue, are there any questions?
I noticed you brought all, oh sorry.
Can you go back to your memory write back stage slide? No, the one where you talk about just the memory write back, it's like a feedback. Is that RA and the next RA, is that the same physical register or those two different physical registers?
Two different registers, they're just both being fed the same destination address. So then we can utilize it.
They're just sending all 15 bits of the three addresses.
Yes, exactly.
And then the 19? You just keep on passing the same 19 control signals whether you needed them all or not?
Yeah, just to simplify and ensure that the controllers were
good. No problem.
Any other questions? So I understand it's hard to see, unfortunately, but this is the instruction memory that we use to test our pipeline. At the same time, we also fed this same instruction memory into our baseline multi-cycle to kind of do some comparison for the usage. This first giant block right here is actually doing Louis Ori's, but what we're doing is just trying to load the registers and testing the EXMEM forwarding logic. The next part right here, we're just testing various instructions and making sure that these different instructions are working properly, and at the same time we're also testing the EXMEM forwarding logic as well. And lastly, we're also testing R-type instruction, and this is very important because R-type requires the usage of both RS and RT. So the forwarding out logic for that was a little bit different. It required us to really take a look into the addresses of both RS and RT and make sure that both muxes were working properly. As a result of our instruction memory, this is what we have in the pipeline. Again, we apologize that we won't be able to see it too well, but as we at least color-coded it so that you guys can see it a little bit easier. Now, for each of these colors, it represents that same data that's flowing down the pipeline. So for this orange one on the side, we're doing a Lui into register one of 1010. And as you see here, it gets fetch decode, it gets put into the DTMUX, which is where we store it before we send it back down to the ALU. It gets fed through the ALU, and it's a Lui, so it goes up into the upper intermediate. And then it goes into the last stage, which is the write-back stage, typically used for memory, but regardless, we still need to store that data appropriately within the last stage. And then lastly, it gets written to the register file. At the same time this is all happening, though, we also performed an ORI instruction. The ORI instruction happens in this blue right here, which gets fetch decode. The media value comes in. At the same time, right here is where it's really important. The ORI requests the data from the previous instruction. So the 1010 that you saw in the previous instruction appears right there. From there, it goes through the ALU, so 1010 ORI with 2020 comes out to be the 10102020. So essentially, we can see that our Lui ORI is working properly. And then lastly, it gets held in the right the memory stage, and then written into the register file. So this is essentially just all Lui ORIs, is working throughout the entire pipeline as we expected it to. Now, let's get into the memory context. So after executing both of the instruction memories in both architectures, this is the result of our work. We saw that all the values were exactly the same in both the multi-cycle and the pipeline. But the key difference between this is that the multi-cycle was able to complete this in 755 nanoseconds. But our pipeline was able to complete it in 305. Essentially, our pipeline was able to execute these instructions 246% quicker than the multi-cycle.
How many of those did you do?
Excuse me?
Lui ORIs back to back, how many? Like those things, what if we did 1,000 of them?
1,000 of them, the efficiency would go up tremendously.
You didn't check that though, like once the pipeline is full. Because that was for your given example, the 246. Mm-hmm. What if you did more?
If I did more?
Yeah, it seems like it would go up. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you did 100 back-to-back Lui ORIs.
I don't think I want to write that much code. It seems like a long time to do that. So, and I think if we were trying to put it on this slide, you'd literally see little specks.
No, we would believe you. We would trust you. You don't have to show us.
Well, thank you, Mr. Adams. So after that, after verifying everything, Jacob will go on to talk about the enhancements.
So due to time, we weren't able to implement some of the hardware that we wanted to. So like for example, we didn't get to the multiply and divide instructions. We had a little bit of wiring issues on that, so we were actually working on that just to hopefully get that working. And then we didn't have time to actually get the load word. But we do realize it is a little bit easier to get that implemented just by adding a no-op instruction or a stall. And then lastly, since we wanted to get to it, and it wasn't even part of the presentation, to implement the jump and branch instructions. So that requires us to add a control hazard, which is fairly more complex than the forward loop. And then lastly, to implement an interrupt for the entire design. So all of these are going to be in the next edition or next processor of the LX5P2440. That concludes our presentation. Are there any other questions?
So you might want to make clear that you actually had two processors. So you did the multiple cycle, it did all the modules,
yeah.
It did interrupts, it did everything. But then you also modified it to create this guy. And how long did you spend on that?
On the pipeline?
Yeah, from taking what worked and then...
I'd say a good 3 weeks.
Three?
Yeah, the biggest issue that I had with everything was just the forwarding logic to ensure that it was actually working properly. And staring at waveforms on it, which was... not the best, but I was able to get it.
And didn't you try doing the branch unit?
I didn't. Not
okay, then.
Yeah, but that is going to be included in the next version. Yes.
And can so, you go into a little bit more detail about how you avoided the hazard when you're doing Louie and Ori next to each other? Just like maybe explain that a little bit more.
Oh, yeah,
about
sure.
How you
let's go back
skipped
to
over that one.
For the forwarding, or do you want
forwarding?
So as Jacob said earlier, we're saving all the addresses throughout the stages of the pipeline, correct? So each and every, the RS, RT, and RD are saved every stage throughout. And yes, we just saved it, even if we're not using it, just to simplify the process
right.
a little bit. So what we're doing is we're, let's say you have an instruction already set in the write the memory, or execute memory stage, correct? That's the fourth stage. Yes, that's fourth stage. And then you also have something in the IDEX that is requesting information from the previous instruction. What that does is it compares the addresses of the two, the RD of the previous and the current RS or RT, and makes a decision based on that. So that's how we're able to know whether we're going to be putting a 2 in the MUX or a 1 in the MUX. A 2 in the MUX would take it from the DD MUX, and a 1 would take it from the Y MUX, which is right in front of the ALU. The DD MUX is actually past the data memory in front of that, in front of the two registers.
Okay, so just to make sure I understand it correctly, when you do detect that there's going to be a hazard, you take it from a place further down the pipeline as opposed to just taking it sooner?
Correct.
That's how it's implemented?
Yep. So we have to do a little extra wiring in the original data path to ensure that we can forward the log, forward the data properly. Any other questions? Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Appreciate it.